How's everybody doing? I am no longer tired. I was jet lagged all day yesterday and completely feeling like a zombie. So I'm really excited that I am awake at an appropriate hour and I can actually like function like a normal human being. So this is good. And what I'm going to talk to you today about is the 2 years I spent styling Hillary. An alternative title for this talk was going to be something like Trying and Failing to Save the Republic with CSS. Or as I actually like to call it, the longest 18 months of my life, oh my God. caution may contain politics. I'll try to keep it to a minimum, but given the nature of what I did, it tends to slip in now and then. But yeah, hi, my name is Mina. You can find me online, mina.codes, or my Twitter handle, at Mina Markham, or pretty much anywhere on the internet, I'm at Mina Markham. And I currently work at Slack, so please join the Slack channel and do all things in Slack and keep me employed because I like money and things. I'm also, if you haven't, can't see, but I am wearing Slack socks currently. So I really, really like my new job, if you can't tell. But what I'm gonna do now is talk to you about like the 2 years I spent at Hillary for America. So what I did there was, I did a lot of things while I was there in the span of those 2 years. I broke the homepage. That was actually the first thing I did. That was great. I helped launch a site that was all about trashing Donald Trump. I built the design system. I helped build a dashboard for collecting analytics data. I helped with the ally compliance. I did a new CMS, and I had the time of my life. But what I'm really going to talk about right now are the design system I helped build and the implementation of the redesign of HillaryClinton.com. I should say that I'm going to talk about more about the why of what we did as opposed to the how we did it, just because there's lots of resources for how you can, for learning how to build your own design system. And I kind of wanted to focus on more of the, like, from the trenches of being inside of a campaign and things and challenges that were unique to that experience. So you're probably wondering, how did I even get this gig in the first place? Well, strangely enough, ironically enough, it all started with an email. Okay, so I know what you're thinking, and just go ahead and get the email jokes out of your system. It's fine, I've actually heard them all, so no big deal. But basically, the email I got was something like this, or actually, this is the exact email I got, where it was a very vague email from a person that I had never heard of before, and asking me to do something for a quote-unquote a social good project, and I did what any sane person would do when they get an email like this, is I ignored it completely. I didn't respond for about a week. Luckily, she ended up emailing me back and asking me if I actually wanted to talk to her, and then she told me, so it's for Secretary Clinton. She may or may not be running for president, but if she was, would you want to maybe help work on her website? And after like a month of interviews and vetting and background checks, I finally got a lovely email that said, welcoming me to the team. I was actually the first engineer they hired, which was really cool, but it took me about a month to get there. At the time, I was living in Texas, and the headquarters was in Brooklyn, and so I had to quit my job. I broke the lease on my apartment. I sold my car. I essentially blew up my life to join this team in Brooklyn. And in June 2015, it looked about like this. This is probably like my second or third week on the campaign, where we had about 10 engineers, me, only woman, yay. That changed very quickly, but we had about 10 engineers, and towards the end, we ended up having about 80 people on the team, about 70 engineers and 10 product designers and product managers. So the whole journey of how I built Bootstrap, or how I built Pantsuit, started with Kyle Rush, the director of front end, telling me, we need a Bootstrap. It's pretty much all the direction I got, by the way. And what he meant was, we need some kind of pattern library or some kind of framework to help us build apps more quickly and efficiently. So I'm going to do a little sidebar here and kind of go over some terminology, because it's kind of my attention. A lot of people are confused as to what a design system versus pattern library versus style guide is. So really, the gist of it is naming things is hard. So I'm going to go over like what the specific names are. So first of all, a pattern library would be a standardized library of UI patterns. And this is basically like the design assets themselves, things that a designer would use and create to help build out interfaces. Whereas a CSS framework is the front-end code and the production-ready assets that are consumed by the applications and the products that need to build out these interfaces. A style guide would be the documentation resource that shows how those UI patterns get translated into that front-end framework and how to implement these the patterns in your designs. And then the design system would be the entirety or the entire ecosystem of all things related to both the pattern library, the coding standards, anything that relates to the building of applications using your brand that encompasses a design system. And so when I say I built the design system, I really mean that I helped build this language and this ecosystem of products that explain how to make applications under the Hillary Clinton brand. A better way to look at it is with this, I like this diagram because it kind of gives a more visual explanation of what I'm saying. So a design system kind of can encompass any and all of these things. A style guide, content strategy, voice and tone standards, a UI kit, branding, pretty much all of these things. The design system at Hillary for America kind of encompassed only a few of these things. It didn't really touch on content strategy. It didn't touch on any like two specific brand assets that was handled by our digital and design team, but I was focused more on where the intersection of design and engineering happened. Okay, so Pantsuit, really? Why would you call it Pantsuit? Well, in retrospect, Pantsuit actually feels like the most appropriate, most perfect name, but I, for one, was thoroughly unconvinced of this name, even though I actually came up with it. When they were asking me, like, what should we codename this thing? What should we call it? I had this name that was knocking around in my head for quite some time, and I was like, Pantsuit? No, I can't really do that. No, that's actually great. No, I really can't call it Pantsuit. And this went on for a while, and finally, I just sort of sheepishly said, okay, what about Pantsuit? And everyone stopped for a second, looked at me like, that is brilliant, we're calling it that, that's the best thing I've ever heard in my life. And up until that exact moment, I was convinced it was a horrible idea. Okay, so why did we need Pantsuit? Why did we need to build this thing? We had limited time, limited resources. Why did we decide to devote precious attention to building something like this inside of a campaign? Well, HillaryClinton.com actually consisted of dozens of different products and code bases living under one domain name. So for example, HillaryClinton.com, just the top level domain, that was the content. Everything on that was managed by our content management system. It was managed by the CMS or storytelling team, which happened to be the team that I was a part of. Everything on /donate was managed by another team, different code base, completely different processes. Same with /events, /calls, completely different teams, code bases, and different strategies. So when you're having that many different moving parts all encompassing on one domain, you want to make sure that it looks like a seamless experience. You didn't want to disrupt what the user, in our case, what the average American voter would see. And so we needed a way for our engineers to, one, quickly and efficiently build out multiple products and simultaneously without independence of each other, but also we wanted to maintain the integrity of the UI so we provided a seamless experience for everyone. So basically, we had multiple code bases, but we wanted everything to be under one UI. So at Hillary for America, we had 8 different agile teams underneath the tech umbrella. My stakeholders, being the person who was in charge of the design system, were the content and storytelling team, the team that I was embedded in, our organizing team, fundraising team, the voter team who handled voter-facing applications, whereas the organizing team handled things that were made for our organizers. The engagement team, our data infrastructure team, and the analytics team, they all use this system in one way or another, either for outwardly voter-facing applications or for internal dashboards. My partners in building the design system were, of course, the product and visual designers who were either embedded on the tech team, like product designers, or visual designers who were on the digital team who I would interact with very frequently. And my dependencies or my supports for building Pantsuit were our front end ops and our DevOps. Front end ops helped me build the build system that one generated the documentation site, the style guide, and also compiled all of my SAS into CSS. And the DevOps, they handled the deploying of assets to our NPM instance for our modules as an NPM module, and also on our S3 as a compiled CSS asset. So the Pantsuit team consisted really of just one person, me. I worked on the content management team. I was embedded in it, but Pantsuit was its own separate project that other teams revolved around. So I had two jobs, essentially. I was working on the design system and on my own, and also working as a member of the content management or content strategy team, where I would help build out all pages that were driven by the CMS. You know, this worked out pretty well, because when it came time for me to redo Pantsuit and redo the redesign, working on the team that was doing the redesign in conjunction with helping to with building out Pantsuit meant that I was constantly iterating and consuming my product. I'll talk about that a little bit later, but being embedded on the team and working on the design system was very beneficial in helping me build things very quickly. So luckily, because Kyle, our front-end director, came to me with this project, I didn't have to get a lot of buy-in for it. The enthusiasm was there and the need was clear. But even if I didn't have, like, even when I didn't have to do this big sell, I started off like I normally would if doing something like this, where I took an interface inventory of the UI as it existed when I started. And as you can see, it was kind of all over the place. We had, I don't know, what does that look like? Six or seven different navigation systems we had going on the site at one time. We had several different button styles, lots of different like heading and typefaces going on. And when I built the first version of Pantsuit, I was given very clear instructions. We needed a complete overhaul of the code base to make it more manageable, more modular, and a lot smaller, but I wasn't allowed to change anything visually. The reason I couldn't change anything visually is because we were doing heavy A/B testing and lots of experiments against the UI, and they didn't want anything that I did to kind of do any red flags or false positives when they were doing their experiments. But they did need a clean code base to start from scratch with. So I was given the kind of difficult task of completely rewriting every piece of UI we had without changing anything. It was a little frustrating for me because, as you can see, there were lots of built-in inconsistencies, and I would see them, and I'd automatically want to go ahead and like fix them and change them, and every time I did, he's like, no, put it back, don't change anything. Luckily, when I did the second version of Pantsuit, which is in conjunction with the redesign, I was able to I started from scratch again with a completely new code base, but this time I was able to sort of have an influence and have a say in whether and standardizing any kind of pieces of UI that we had. I started again with interface inventory, but I did it more analog. I didn't take screenshots of an existing site because there was no existing site. I printed out designs that I got from our designer, and I cut them up into pieces, and I started to look for patterns there. Okay, so one of the main reasons why we built something like Pantsuit was so that we can move at the speed that the campaign required. Now, if you think about it, the campaign itself lived for a total of 20 or so months. So that's like not a lot of time in the world of technology. And we needed to, we couldn't spend like 6 months on something like this, because that effectively is like one third of the entire lifespan of the organization building this one product. So timelines were very, very compressed on the campaign. A project that would take maybe, you know, six, 8 months at any kind of tech organization would take maybe a couple of weeks, maybe a month max. Like everything was go, 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 ship fast, ship often. But yeah, no, really, ship really, really fast. So that pace over time meant that we valued being done more than being absolutely perfect. If you waited for something to be perfect, chances are it wouldn't ship when we needed it to. So I built Pantsuit, one version of Pantsuit, in about 6 weeks, and that includes writing CSS architecture, like redoing the CSS architecture, writing standard coding standards for it, building out the component library, implementing prototypes of the site of the pages that I was replicating to make sure I didn't have any visual deviations, make sure there was a one-to-one parity, and then creating an entire documentation site for all the components that I made. So I had to do that in about 6 weeks, and even then, that felt like way too long. Like, I felt bad taking 6 weeks to do this thing. One way that Pantsuit helped people build things very fast is that we had three different ways of consuming it. There was a CDN, NPM modules, and of course, there was a manual download. And the CDN was basically, all versions of Pantsuit were versions and put up on a CDN or on S3. And our backend engineers and our internal applications who didn't have a front-end build system, they would just point to the link on the CDN and would consume the entirety of the CSS framework. Whereas most of our front-end applications had a build system accompanied with it, so they got Pantsuit automatically packaged, included in their package.json as an NPM module, and so they just consumed it that way and built on top of it. Only one team, as far as I'm aware, actually used Pantsuit the way I intended it to be used, which was downloading it manually, picking and choosing which modules you included in your code base, and leaving out all the parts you didn't need. The purpose of me building it modularly was so that people could take what they needed and leave the rest and didn't have to like consume the entirety of the library. Unfortunately, the way that our build system and our processes were implemented, I found out that most people were consuming it either via CDN or via just the NPM module. Nat Welch, one of our SREs, he told me that the reason that he, as a DevOps person, didn't like Pantsuit is because it made it so that they could deploy style changes very quickly over all of our 100+ microsites, and everything was cached very easily and consistently. Excuse me. One thing that I learned on my time at the campaign was that because things move very, very quickly, you have to get used to a certain amount of chaos. And when that translates to technology, basically it means that technical debt becomes your friend. Since I was only one person maintaining this big system, I couldn't police how people were consuming and how people were implementing. I put out the standards, I had the documentation site, and I kind of had to distrust that they were doing what they needed to get done. And even, you know, sometimes myself, I would go ahead and like ignore all the rules that I set forth because things had to ship fast and ship often. So I found myself doing really, really dirty things occasionally and feeling very bad about myself. But basically what this means is that my very official looking graph here, what it says is that over time, our priorities would shift for the code base. At the beginning, we were all about maintainability. Stability was always a constant. We were all about making sure it was maintainable because the truth was, once we built something, it was very unlikely we would go back and be able to refactor or redo anything. So we had to make sure from the beginning it was pretty maintainable and pretty modular so that we didn't run into lots of like code spaghetti at the end. But as time shifted forward and we got closer and closer to election day, we cared less about maintaining the code base because win or lose, our code was going to disappear after election day. So it was more like we wanted to make sure that nothing broke going up into those crucial weeks. And so the stability of the site became more important than the maintainability of the code, which led to many of us doing things like I showed you earlier that made me feel very unclean. Basically, it meant that after a certain point, you kind of had to learn to just let it go and go and do things in a more hacky or scrappy kind of way towards the end of the life cycle of your projects. Okay, so one thing that I learned I got very, very good at towards the in the course of the campaign was communication. Because we were moving so fast and also growing so quickly, there wasn't a lot of room for onboarding people. Like, we kind of needed people to get going and get started very, very quickly. So there wasn't a lot of time to do lots of extensive training or lots of extensive, like, an onboarding process. So there were three different ways that I used as the creator and maintainer of this library that people would eventually gonna need to use. There were three things that I did that helped maintain a cycle of communication and open communication. One was I did lots of automation. Again, I love Slack. I loved Slack before I worked at Slack, but what I did was I used Slack to automate whenever I updated a new version of Pantsuit. So every once in a while, as you were working in a Slack channel, you would see something like this pop up. It would say that a new version of Pantsuit was released. Here are the changelog notes. Here's a documentation site. And I would do that via a webhook integration in Slack. And basically, whenever I did a NPM publish of the new version of Pantsuit, there was a post-publish script hook that would then ping Slack and post this message to the channel with the version number and the link to the appropriate documentation. And lots of people, and this had the benefit of me being able to tell our like 80-some engineers pretty easily and very instantaneously when there was a new version of Pantsuit, and then let them decide whether or not they wanted to update to that new version based on what I wrote in the change logs and based on like the documentation and their needs. I guess I didn't mention before, but Pantsuit was completely opt-in. It wasn't something where you would immediately get the changes as soon as I would publish new ones. We did that for a couple different reasons. One being because there were so many different code bases, and everyone was running like a different version and slightly different, there were like slightly different UIs there going on, but I didn't want to force people into the updated version. Like, even at some point when we did the redesigned site, there were parts of our site that had the redesigned and revamped UI, and there were other parts of it that didn't have the redesigned UI. So we didn't want to force the changes on them. We wanted each individual Agile team to be able to control when they updated, when that kind of work would fit into their deployment cycle. So being able to use Slack to automatically update people when there was a new version allowed them to get the information they needed to see whether or not this update was something that they wanted to implement. Another thing that really helped was documentation. Like I said before, we ramped up engineers very quickly. We went from like 0 to 80 in the span of maybe a year or so. And each team had their own Agile process. And everyone had a different tech stack and a different code base, different processes. And so I didn't want to be that roadblock for people to try to implement a new site. I didn't want my project to be the roadblocking for them. So it was very important that I created very extensive documentation on what Pantsuit was, how to implement it, how to consume it, how to use it. So I used KSS Node to parse the CSS comments that I made in my SAS files to generate this documentation site. And this is the link that people would get in that Slack hook that's sending them to this site so they can see what the new versions entailed. So basically what I did was I told them how they consume Pantsuit if they needed to with the CDN, the manual, or the NPM modules. And I went through and I documented everything from the grid systems. The grid system itself was a mobile-first grid system that gave you lots of different flexibility. Like, it was a 12-base grid system, but you could do it Fluent. You can have a small grid system. You can have incomplete columns, push and pull. So it was a very robust grid system. It also showed all the different components that were there. And it went through all the SAS logic that I used to create some of these things so that if something that they needed wasn't there, they had access to the SAS tools that I used to build them to build their own. And then for the designers, it also documented all of the color palettes and all of the branding. And the last thing I did was I included starter kits or templates for people to use to get like updated really quickly, so they can get started really quickly with some very basic layouts and templates. And I got some really good feedback for the documentation side, because it basically it meant that no one really asked me questions. And I took that as a sign that I did something right, where people didn't feel the need to constantly come to me and ask how to use this thing, because they found almost everything they needed on the site. And as Beth says, it wasn't just documenting what existed, it also showed them like how to create their own and serve the, as a source of inspiration for people to kind of go off of and build their own UIs. And the last thing the last communication tool that I used was very extensive collaboration. What this basically meant was that I would do a lot of things live with the design team as we were implementing the redesign of the site. Victor, our main web designer, he and I would have these twice a week pixel engineering sessions where he and I would sit down and go over the UI as it existed, like the scaffolding I did or whatever components I finished in the last couple days. And we would test it and decide whether or not it was working at the various breakpoints. And then whenever we spotted any kind of inconsistencies or any kind of problems, we would iterate on it in the browser at that time. And it was a kind of a pair programming situation, although Victor didn't code, but it was more of like a pair design coding situation. And this way, we were just kind of able to do like real time, like debugging and implementation of the new site. It also meant that I learned how to consume my own products. If I built Pantsuit like in isolation, where I didn't actually have to implement it in the redesign as I was building it, it would have meant that I wouldn't been able to spot some of the like weird intricacies with the with the breakpoints that I did when I was building it live. So one thing I did when how I went about this process was I defined the components. I defined the components. I would implement them. I would then sit down with Victor and I would test them both like in the browser and on various devices. And then he and I would iterate on them at that time. And then depending on what we would find, I would then go back and redefine either new components or redefine new components and then re-implement it. Kind of just like the iteration cycle of consuming, iterating. And Victor and I formed this thing called the Pantsuit Council. And what that consisted of was me, Victor, who was the design lead on Pantsuit, all of our designers, and any other front-end dev who wanted to sit in on the meetings where we would decide what would go into Pantsuit, meaning what kind of components would we add to the library itself. If anyone was having any kind of problems with it, we would talk about whether or not we needed to address them. Kind of just going over like the state of the UI at that time. I included this GIF, I think it's funny, but we had these weekly check-ins with our major stakeholders to decide whether or not we needed to expand or include anything the designers themselves were working on in the library of Pantsuit for everyone to use, and whether or not we needed to remove certain things that people weren't necessarily using all the time. So this is what the redesigns of HillaryClinton.com look like for the second version of Pantsuit. And if you happen to look at it on my computer when I was doing the design, it actually looked a little bit like this, or actually it looked exactly like this. I stared at the site for maybe every day for about 4 months, and I really wanted to enjoy what I was looking at, so I put Beyonce everywhere. And I use this thing called placebeyonce.com, and I highly recommend it. It made my job a lot more fun. But really what mattered was whether or not the people I was building Pantsuit for actually enjoyed using it, if it actually was helpful for them. And Kyle, using very flourishy fashion language basically told me that it was the best tool that we had, that he had at his disposal. And that made me feel like I actually had done my job. Like, I don't think Kyle asked me a question once about Pantsuit the entire time he was using it, but he ended up building out the entirety of the slash calls or the call tool using Pantsuit. And the fact that he was able to start that code base from scratch, have it look seamlessly like the rest of HillaryClinton.com, and then didn't necessarily need to turn to me every time you want to implement something, meant that I had done a pretty good job of both communicating and documenting everything that I was doing. But what really made me feel like myself and the rest of the design team and the team who did the redesign, that we had done a very good job, was when this message came across our Slack team. It's from Teddy Goff, who is an advisor of Hillary Clinton, and he got a message from her saying that she saw the site and was really excited about it and said a little kudos. So that made me feel like, you know what? I think I can handle everything that's going on right now. Like, I think I'm gonna be all right. Okay. Okay, so now I wanna talk about something that's a little less fun, a thing that happened to me and is still happening to me based on my work with Hillary Clinton. Trolling the vote. Believe it or not, there are a lot of people like to talk about you when you work for one of the most famous women in the world. Like, the reason I'm here is because I used to work for Hillary Clinton. And while I, for the most part, received good communications from people, every once in a while I would get something that was really, really disturbing, particularly from the people who were supporting our main opponent. And there's just undeniable truth that working for Hillary Clinton kind of exposed you to a level of vitriol that I have never personally experienced in my life. Spoiler alert, Reddit is a wasteland. I would highly avoid it at all costs. But my name tended to pop up on that site more often than I would like. Now, it takes a certain amount of fortitude to be a woman on the internet, just in general. Add on to that being a black woman, and a black woman who worked for Hillary Clinton, one of the most controversial figures of our time. And I didn't have a lot of fun for a while. Shortly after I published my Pantsuit post, it brought me to the attention of a group of people that I didn't really want to gain their attention. People call them the alt-right. I call them deplorable man children with too much time on their hands. But they found out who I was. yeah. After I published the post, I hit their radar and, you know, some stuff happened. I ended up on several different Reddit threads where people were basically telling me that I was stupid, I was an idiot, I was shit, I had zero professional skills, zero security. Like, it was just not a good thing. And at some point, they tried to dox me. I don't think they actually succeeded, because our security engineer is actually very, very good at his job, and I think he shut it down. But I was made aware of a doxing threat against me, and just lots of like horrible messages that are a lot worse than what I put up here. And it didn't actually stop after the campaign. Like, a couple months ago, I appeared in a Cosmopolitan article about some of the women who used to work for Hillary Clinton and like what we did post-campaign. And it was a nice, fun article basically saying, like, you know, we're all right, we're surviving. And yeah, for some reason, like, that still attracted a lot of hateful comments. Like, who has time to do this? Who cares? Anyways, sorry. Normally, I try to let these kind of comments slide. Like, I don't like to engage because really, just I have other things to do with my time. But every once in a while, like, I can't help myself, and I feel the need to reply just a little bit, just to make myself feel better. But I guess the point I'm trying to make is sometimes people are terrible, and even though, like, I loved what working there and I loved what I did, it's still like, it had an effect on me that I haven't quite recovered from. But in addition to people being terrible, sometimes, you know, they're just wrong. Like, this person here insisted that I couldn't possibly have coded any of that myself and use this console, we had a console message and a like code comments in our markup, and he insisted that because of this, there's no way that I could possibly have done it. Well, actually, he's wrong. This is exactly my work. And yeah, I just sometimes, just maybe people just shouldn't talk. But that actually leads me to my last little point about Pantsuit. A lot of people ask me, is it open source? When's it going to be open source? Why haven't you open sourced it? And during the campaign, it became very clear that I wasn't going to be able to open source something like this. And the reason is not necessarily obvious, unless in hindsight. But most companies who open source their design system or their pattern library don't necessarily have a huge risk of people trying to impersonate them for nefarious reasons. But when you're in the middle of a political campaign that's very heated, people want to have any kind of edge they can against you. And for one, you don't want to give the opposition any sort of fuel to harm you with. But you also don't want to inadvertently lend credence to any illegitimate or misinformation campaign. So here's a couple of ads that were done by the campaign, by our designers that appeared on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter. I say ads, really were just posts that were official telling people to text us for various bits of information. And here is a fake one that was created by, I actually have no idea, but this was circulated around Twitter and Facebook and the same social media networks, urging people to text by vote. Now, I don't know how many of you are familiar with American elections, but you cannot text by vote. This is a lie. They were trying to, you know what, let me back up. I don't know for a fact that they were trying to suppress votes, but they were definitely misleading people to believe that they could legitimately vote by texting. And they did this based solely on the open CSS that existed on our site, the stuff that the browser needs in order, you know, to do its job. They downloaded the font based off of our CDN, they grabbed the colors. Any person who knows anything about web design and web development will be able to get this information. Now, I learned about this because one of our directors pinged me and he asked me, can you remove the font from the site, or can you hide the font, or can you make it so you can't download it? Of course, I told him no, because there's no way I can do that and still have it render. And he said, well, people are trying to make fake ads to discourage people or mislead people into voting. Now, the fact that they could do that just based on the CSS that needed to be there, that needed to exist for the site to function, it became very clear that there was no way we were going to be able to actually open source and put out the legitimate instructions on how to build something that was branded with our assets, because then we didn't want to give this any more credence and any more reason to look legitimate. Okay, so I told you a lot of like good and bad stories, but people like to ask me, after it's all said and done and after a, let's face it, devastating loss, was it all worth it? And when I look back at that time, I really just remember the joy of being there and being in that moment. This is a photo taken at one of the rare occasions that Secretary Clinton was in the campaign office. And she came because she wanted to meet us. She wanted to see the people who had dedicated their time and their energy to help her become president. And we had a really good time just talking to her and explaining to her what our jobs were. She told us, I think the reason we're laughing is because she told us that I don't understand anything any of you all do, but I really appreciate all of you doing it. And probably the highlight of my life and my career was when I got to demo HillaryClinton.com to Hillary Clinton herself. Like, that's something that, yeah, no one else can say, and it's yeah, definitely one of like the one. I'm gonna start crying. Forgive me. That was one of the best experiences of my life. And even after the loss, seeing the outpour of love we got, this was written on the sidewalk outside of HQ the day after the election. We found a bunch of kids outside scribbling on the sidewalk, making thank you messages and drawings and things. And let me tell you, that day we really, really, really needed it. And seeing the people of New York in the subway putting up this random and completely unplanned mural of Post-its with words of encouragement and words of thanks and words of like strength really helped me and the rest of the team get through a not very pleasant time in our lives. And then of course there was the candidate herself, whom this was taken the Friday after Election Day, I guess 3 days after arguably the worst night of her life. And in this picture, she is consoling me. She is telling me that it will be okay, that we will keep fighting, that she is proud of me, and the fact that she was able to do that, to smile, to laugh, that made me feel like I would go ahead and be able to do it again too. So I guess my point is, when people ask me about this time and was it worth it, when people look back at 2016 and ask me where I was and what I was doing and what I was feeling, and ask me, was it worth it, I'll be able to say, yeah, it was, because I was there. I was in the middle of it. I was helping to make history. I was living history. I was literally right there. So my answer to whether or not the whole thing was worth it would be a resounding hell yes. Thank you.